Hi, Steve from Steve M Outdoors here today with a quick little video for people who are interested in collecting military surplus rifles, or MILSURPs as they're commonly known. This video is kind of geared more towards the person who's moved past the I bought my first SKS, I bought my first Mosin Nagant kind of stage and now wants to get a little more serious about it. So these are a couple little tips and things that I think you need before you embark on that road. The first one is mechanical skills and problem-solving skills. What a lot of people forget is, despite the fact that these are military rifles, so they tend to have a higher standard they have to meet before they're accepted into service, a lot of times you're collecting old rifles and old mechanical objects, which is what a firearm is at the end of the day, can have its issues. Even originally when they were introduced into service, there could be issues. The SVT-40, you know, was kind of known for being a little finicky with its gas system. Now when you have a rifle 70 years later, an SVT-40, you know, that gas system can be a pain in the ass, magnified by, you know, who knows how well it was cleaned, you know, firing corrosive ammunition, as militaries often did, and perhaps still do. So issues can crop up, and it's really important that you have the mechanical skills necessary to fix these rifles if you intend on firing them. I'm not a collector, I'm not a wall, you know, collecting things to put on the wall. I shoot everything that I buy. So mechanical skills are good. Problem-solving skills also, you can substitute that though for the expertise of the World Wide Web. There are a lot of great YouTube videos on troubleshooting older firearms, and there's also incredible resources like MILSURP.com, Canadian Gun Nuts, Gun Owners of Canada, AR15.com, more gun boards than I could probably care to mention or even remember. So learn how to fix that which you are buying, because unless you want to not fire them at a certain point, you're going to have to know how to fix them. Number two is reloading. I think it's a very good idea that if you're going to collect military surplus rifles, you should start getting into reloading. You know, once you move past the rifles a lot of people own, SKS-45s, Mosin Nagant M9130s, Mausers of, you know, common caliber like 8mm, M1 Garands and all that stuff with the 30-06, you're going to start to get into issues of finding ammunition, or finding ammunition that you can fire without having to mortgage your home. You know, even stuff like 7.62x54R, which is fired by the SVT and the Mosin Nagant N9130 and all those other rifles of that Eastern Bloc, that's starting to get expensive now. Those surplus supplies have dried up thanks to the war in the Ukraine and Crimea between the Ukrainians and the Russians. Plus, a lot of that stuff is now being kind of shunted aside and being sent off to Syria or, you know, wherever. So reloading will allow you to, one, have ammunition for your rifle, and two, probably cheaper than you can buy it in the store. You know, even a box of 303 British, which is still commercially made by any number of companies, it's getting expensive. It's about $30 now for a box of 20 rounds up here in Canada. So you're looking at over $1 a round, like $1.20, whatever it may be. You know, you can reload that. I mean, if you cast your own bullets, if you want to go that far, but you can reload that using, you know, off the shelf from store components for about 60 to 70 cents, depending on, you know, what kind of components, powder, and all that stuff that you're using. So reloading is a great idea. Also, for stuff that you can't buy commercially, I have an Infanteriegewehr 7184. The German battle rifle from the 1880s, and it fires the 11mm round. Good luck finding that. It hasn't been commercially produced in 60 years probably, and finding ammunition for that rifle is next to impossible. You might come across a box, you know, every now and then. Even brass for that is crazy expensive. From Bertram Brass out in Australia, you're paying over $100 for 20 cases. So learn to reload, and you can cut the costs down. So you can either shoot more, spending the same amount of money, or shoot the same, and you'll definitely save a lot of money. The upfront costs are there in terms of reloading equipment, dies, and all that stuff. You can make that as expensive or as cheap as you want. If you want a Lee single stage breech lock press that you can buy the whole anniversary kit for, you know, I don't know, $150 or whatever it is up here in Canada, that's a great starter set and allowed you to load quality ammunition for almost every caliber there is. So reloading, excellent idea to get into. Money is a good thing to have when you're collecting military surplus rifles. You can still buy rifles, over a century old military service rifles, for a couple of $100 up here in Canada, and presumably maybe even cheaper in the United States. But not all of them. Particularly if you want like the OG original stuff. You know, if you want a World War I M1911, you're paying. That's a couple of $1,000 right off the hop. You're paying, you want a beautiful example of a K98K, the German infantry rifle from World War II, you're going to pay, okay? Up here in Canada, that rifle can fetch, you know, $1,500 to $2,000, no problem, okay, right off the hop. You want a beater, you can find one probably for about $500 or $600, but if you want something that's nice, you're going to pay. There's no question about that. Other rifles, I mean, you can find really nice SKS-45s for a few $100, M9130s, assuming there is such a thing as a nice one, again, for a couple $100. But once you start getting out of the common mil serfs that everyone owns, start getting into the rarer stuff, boy, you're going to be spending money. Another thing, too, is you're going to need money for ammunition that you can't reload. I was looking at a Kropacek rifle a couple months ago at a gun show. The rifle itself was pretty cheap. I think it was about $700. Beautiful rifle. Thing is, it's a rimfire rifle. Where in the hell are you going to find rimfire ammunition from the 1880s? You're not. So you're either going to be spending a hell of a lot of money buying this ammunition, or you're going to have to, again, going back to point two, learn how to reload. And then again, how many people can actually reload rimfire ammunition? It can be done. And there are videos on YouTube that you can find to learn how to do it, but it's not easy. Yeah, so the ammunition is going to cost you a hell of a lot of money. Number four, this one's kind of a harder skill to develop, common sense, slash research. When you know, prices for military surplus rifles can vary depending on where you are in the country. You know, in the United States, a lot of the stuff that's crazy expensive up here is fairly relatively inexpensive. And vice versa, there's stuff that in the United States that's expensive. SKS-45s, bog standard. They made 17 million of the damn things. They're expensive in the United States, cheap in Canada because of the embargo against Russian arms in the United States. M9130s. You can buy them for like $200 up here in Canada. They're like $400 or $500 in the United States. Yeah. M1 Garands in the United States, cheap up here in Canada. I paid $2,000 last December for one. Granted, a very nice example of one, but it's still $2,000. It's a lot of money. So use common sense when you're trying to figure out how much a firearm costs, how much you're willing to spend. Let me give you a good example. This dovetails into the research. I was at a gun auction a couple years ago when I was first getting into military surplus rifles, and I really wanted a Japanese war rifle, and there was one up for auction. It was a Type 38 Arisaka. Had I done the research on it, you know, I probably would have capped my bidding at about $400 to $500, given the condition that it was in. And even that might have been a little expensive. I ended up paying a lot more for that because I didn't do my research and I didn't know exactly how much they were worth. And I paid enough for that rifle that years later, the local gun community calls me Jap Steve in honor of that rifle purchase. To this day, I can walk into a local gun store and they'll say, "Hey, Jap Steve." It was all based on spending way too much on that Type 38 Arisaka. So do your research, find out how much something is supposed to actually cost, because you can overpay. But you can also underpay if you find something that's at below market value and you want it, you know, grab it while you can. You should also do the research component on the firearms themselves. There's a lot of fakes in the military surplus community. Not as, quite as much as people think, but there are certain rifles that do tend to get faked. A good example of that is the Lee Enfield Jungle Carbine. Everyone wants one until they fire it, then they're not as much keen on it as they used to be. But a lot of jungle carbines out there are absolute fakes. And, you know, there was a company in the United States that imported a bunch of Lee Enfields, chopped the barrel, you know, added a conical flash hider, you know, put some kind of rubber buttstock on it, and boom, now they suddenly had jungle carbines, and people were spending hundreds of dollars on each one of those. And they're still in the marketplace today. You can find, you know, these jungle carbines. And people are paying five, six, $700 for them, and they're not worth it because they're not real jungle carbines. Part and parcel on doing research too is being able to tell what condition a rifle is in terms of having its original components. A lot of rifles, you know, they're mix masters. You know, some guy bought a sportered Lee Enfield, to take an example. Bought a stock off, you know, some company, put the new stock on. Maybe the bolt was screwed up, so they put a new bolt in that stuff. They have a functional Lee Enfield, but it's not an original Lee Enfield. It's got, you know, components from different rifles now, and one not even original component in the stock. So, you know, you should do the research to find out what exactly it is that you're buying and what's real, what's not. Yeah, common sense and research, very important. Or otherwise, you could go down a road where you're spending a lot of money on stuff that really isn't worth the price. But conversely, you may also want to buy it. I bought a Lee Enfield, you know, number of, I can't even remember which Lee Enfield it was, but it was a rifle that was put together from different components. I knew that going in. You know, totally original Lee Enfields are really starting to increase in price now, even up here in Canada, because everyone who's got one is keeping it. You know, they're not tending to go back onto the marketplace anymore. This one cost me about $500, but it is a remarkable condition with a new stock. I think the sights on it were not original to that rifle, but original, you know, they're legitimate Lee Enfield sights. But I paid knowing what it was, and I paid a slightly below market value knowing that it wasn't a totally stock Lee Enfield. But it was worth it because it was a great rifle, and it is, continues to be this, to this day. So that's basically it. Those are just a couple of things that I think you need to have or know if you're going to start collecting military surplus rifles. It's a great hobby once you get into it. Don't go into it thinking that you're going to make money. A lot of people think, well, firearms only ever appreciate in value. You know, things can change at a moment's notice. You know, for a while, SKS 45s, I think it was in the 90s, were starting to get expensive. People were buying them based on speculation, thinking, wow, you know, they're going to be worth $400 or $500 in 10 years. And then all of a sudden, the market was flooded again with more SKS 45s. Suddenly, the price dropped to below $200. And they were stuck with, you know, $300, $350 SKSs that now they can't sell. You know, right now, SVT 40s are really starting to jump, go up in price. I've seen them listed as high as $800 for a rifle that, you know, 3 years ago you could pay, you know, under $400 for, you know, one of the ones manufactured at Izbishek, however you pronounce that, or Tula. Now those rifles are going up for like about $700 just because the supply is pretty much dried up. But the situation in the Crimea resolves, and all of a sudden the Ukrainians release all those rifles they have in the salt mines. You know, SVT 40s can go down to price again, down to $300. So if you're buying on speculation, hoping to make money, forget that. Collect because you enjoy the hobby, you enjoy the history that is integral to each piece. You know, imagine at night, you know, what soldier carried that rifle and what battle, you know, those are great things. But if you're doing it just to try and make money, you know, it's speculation at best. At any rate, thanks very much for watching. I hope you found this at least vaguely informative. If you did, please feel free to like and share. It helps out the channel. Subscribe if you like, and down below you will find links to Twitter, my Twitter page where there are more frequent updates, and Facebook where I tend to write longer form articles on things. At any rate, have a great day. Happy shooting. Safe shooting.